Oh boy, here comes the smoke.
It is AliExpress time. And for those who are new to this video series, AliExpress is an online shop where you can order stuff directly from China. What makes it special though is that mostly only there you can find the newest and thus most interesting items when it comes to electronics and similar. But then again, there's also lots of garbage on the site. And that is why today I will be testing 6 more products from AliExpress to determine whether you should check them out or simply ignore them. Let's get started! Don't skip this ad from Keysight if you like free test gear, because Keysight Live from the Lab is back for 2023. And it's now a bi-monthly live-streamed series. You can sign up today using my link below. And if you're curious, the first stream will break down conventional PCB design wisdom to see if it's any good, and if it holds up in extreme situations, like what happens when you dip a board in liquid nitrogen. Sign up now to find out, and for your chance to win over $300,000 of Keysight gear. If you use my link, you'll get an extra entry. And Keysight is also giving away a bonus scope just for my viewers who use this link. The first item I got this time was a viewer recommendation. And after plugging it into a USB port of a computer, it basically still functions like a USB port, meaning it can power stuff and it can also transfer data like usual. Because what we're looking at is actually a USB isolator, which you can get for around 6 euro. Like the name implies, the input and output side is completely isolated from one another. Easy to spot because my multimeter didn't beep. But to still get data from one side to the other, the product uses the ADUM3160 USB digital isolator that can handle 2500 volts for about a minute before breaking down. I said that specifically because the headline of the product says 1500 volts, the description 3000 volts, and the datasheet 2500 volts. I guess 3 values are better than 1. But anyway, to get power from one side to the other, the board uses this black box, which is most certainly a 5 volt DC isolated power supply. Okay, now that we know what the board can do, why would you want to use it? Well, the first example that came to my mind was when building a homemade Bluetooth audio system, consisting of such a small amp and a Bluetooth receiver. As you can hear, the amp amplifies unwanted interference noises created by the Bluetooth receiver, because they share the same power and ground line. But by using the USB isolator, we can get rid of the ground loop, and thus our low-cost Bluetooth audio system now works flawlessly. Another very similar example is when utilizing USB audio recording equipment, because that also loves to capture the noise inside of your computer. But once again, by using the USB isolator, we can get rid of most of the noise. And remember these USB killers Electroboom made a video about? Yeah, I think such a USB isolator could save your computer in such a case. So all in all, a pretty nifty product if you got the right application for it. The only downsides are that it noticeably slows down the data transfer, and you can also only draw around 200 milliamps through it before the voltage drops too much. But aside from that, I would recommend it. Now I ordered the next two products after freezing on last year's Christmas markets, and those products are electrically heated gloves and socks. And long story short, they both work remarkably well, but I was curious to find out how much of a fire hazard they would be, because high power batteries, heated wire and fabric does not mix so well. So let's start off with the gloves that I got for around 45 euro at the time. They come with two not so confidence inspiring battery packs and one charger with two outputs, meaning you can charge both batteries simultaneously. What I immediately noticed though was that the charger outputs were wired up in parallel, meaning when charging the batteries, you basically put them in parallel. And that can be really dangerous if one of them is more charged up than the other. So needless to say, I charged up the batteries individually. And as soon as that was done, I put them inside the gloves, turned them on, and enjoyed the warmth. Kidding, I of course measured the temperature on the inside, as well as the current consumption while using all three heating modes, and compared that to the data given by the manufacturer. And I have to say, they only exaggerated a little bit. So next, I took apart one battery pack, and my only recommendation here would have been to use a more sturdy enclosure. But other than that, it seems like a proper battery protection circuit was in place. Nice. Before my final judgment though, I of course also took one glove apart, in order to find out that the heated wire was well secured and could never cause any kind of fire with the given battery voltage. That can only happen if you use way more voltage and thus power. But all in all, due to the not well protected battery pack and the sketchy charging methods, I would still not recommend this product. Now the socks on the other hand, which I got for a similar price, came with a better housing for the battery and also featured a proper charging circuit. So no more sketchy parallel charging. Other than that, they also worked pretty well, they only slightly exaggerated with their temperature and runtime, and the construction of them is also rather safe, and can only be a fire hazard when I'm cranking up my lab bench power supply. So all in all, I would actually recommend them, even though they are a bit pricey. But moving on to the next product, which is a human presence radar that you can get for around 9 euro. Now I think when it comes to sensing presence, then we're all familiar with such PIR sensors that turn on their outputs as soon as someone gets too close. And you can of course fine adjust the distance at which the sensor reacts. So the question is, why would you want to use such a radar instead? Well, according to its product description, it uses 24 GHz waves that can not only identify non-moving humans, it can also penetrate through barriers, and you can fine adjust at what distance exactly the system should react. That all sounds pretty awesome, so I downloaded the given software from the description, connected the board to my computer, and gave it all a go. Which initially looked a bit confusing though. But in a nutshell, we only care about the moving target and motionless target diagram, in which each number on the x-axis represents a distance that increases by 0.75 meters, and the y-axis is pretty self-explanatory. To test this, I prepared a basic setup in my 4.5 meter long corridor, attached the sensor to the wall, and monitored on my computer what it was spitting out while I was moving and standing around at different distances. And I gotta say, I was rather impressed, because both detection outputs, moving and standing, were not only very reactive, but also unexpectedly accurate, without fine-tuning anything. And yes, it also works through non-metal barriers. And since the sensor communicates via UART, you can easily integrate it into DIY projects, meaning that for me, it is a definite recommendation if you're looking for a more precise and customizable PIR sensor alternative. With that being said, here comes the last viewer recommendation, which is this 50 amp Wi-Fi relay that I got for around 15 euro. It can be mounted inside most European breaker boxes, and can be used to turn on or off electrical circuits using your smartphone, or what I was more interested in, using Home Assistant. So to test it, I simply powered it via mains voltage, which, by the way, you should not do if you're not a professional. After then downloading the required app, I paired the relay and was basically ready to turn on and off all kinds of appliances. Now of course, you can set schedules, timers and loops when the relay should trigger, which is all fine and good. But what I didn't like was that they pretty much forced me to create an account if I wanted to use this relay with Google, Alexa, or like previously said, Home Assistant. But on the plus side, after taking it apart, I have to say that it is decently made. But I honestly also doubt that this relay is really suited for 50 amp spikes. So all in all, I would personally not recommend it. But if you have no problem with more counts and want to switch only small loads, then this could be a good fit. And just like that, we come to the last product, which is this fingerprint reader I got for around 23 euro. I got interested in it after I did my RFID lock hacking video, and was curious to find out whether it could be a good lock alternative that is reliable and safe. I mean, according to its product description, the false recognition rate should be under 0.001%, so 1 in every 100,000 attempts. Not bad. To test it, I wanted to connect it to an Arduino, but I quickly noticed that the product description does not come with a fitting pinout diagram. By googling the IC number, however, I eventually found a usable one and tried it out. But no matter how often I tried or with what pins, the Adafruit Arduino library didn't recognize it. After spending lots of time on this, I could not find the problem, and instead got myself a slightly different fingerprint reader that comes with more information in the product description. And after hooking this one up, it worked on the first try, and thus I could easily store my fingerprint in the reader and then use it as identification to briefly light up an additional blue LED. At this point, I did an excessive amount of testing to make sure that the reader only triggers on this one specific finger, and I gotta say, it really did the job just fine. Even after programming in another fingerprint and testing for maybe around half an hour, the reader never triggered falsely. Very nice. So in conclusion, I can definitely recommend this product, and I actually already have a good project for it in mind. But for now, my testing session is over, and this time I surprisingly got more recommendations than negative products. Awesome! Of course, there's lots more good stuff and garbage to discover on AliExpress, so be on the lookout for the next episode in this video series. If you enjoyed it so far, then consider supporting me through Patreon. As always, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!